Welcome to the Joint COVID Task Force briefing. We'll start with a few slides today. Total COVID-19 cases to date, 232,596. New cases reported today, 432. Next slide. Of those new cases, 92 are pediatric cases. The new case rates have declined for all ages and children 17 and under quite rapidly since mid-January. Next slide. The 7-day average of cases per day is now 458. That is down significantly from the 1,754 average this time last week. The 7-day average test positivity rate has also decreased since last week. It is now 13.2%, down from 17.3% this time last week. Next slide. The effective reproductive number, or RT, of the virus is now 0.62, down from 0.72 last week. Total COVID-19 positive hospitalizations as of Sunday, February 6th, 438, with 100 in the ICUs and 338 in acute care. We have noted what appears to be a downward trend in hospitalizations since the end of January. Next slide. Currently, there are 6,042 active cases in Shelby County, which is almost a 50% decrease from the 11,406 active cases just 1 week ago. Active cases among children ages 0 to 17 remain the highest of all age groups at 775 cases. Cases among all other ages have continued a downward trend that began several weeks ago. Pediatric cases now make up 29.9% of all active cases, as cases have declined in all other age categories. But as you can see in these graphs, we are beginning to see a significant downward trend among pediatric cases as well. Next slide. This map shows active cases by zip code, with the darker areas representing areas that have more active cases at this time. Next slide. And this map shows pediatric cases by zip code, also with the darker areas representing areas where there are more active pediatric cases at this time. Next slide. This graph compares average case rates of children age 5 to 18 years old in the 6 metro counties of Tennessee. Shelby County, shown in blue, shows a significant decrease beginning in mid-January. The other metro counties have also seen decreases, while Sullivan, Knox, and Madison counties still have the highest rates. Next slide. This graph shows vaccinations by vaccination date, with first, second, and third doses shown in differing shades of blue. In the past 7 days, 2,426 vaccinations have been given in Shelby County. An average of 347 vaccinations were given each day in Shelby County over the past 7 days. Vaccinations have declined throughout January and into February, a trend we are working to reverse. Next slide. Here, you see the breakdown of the vaccinated population by age. 59.2% of Shelby County's overall population has received at least one dose of vaccine, and the percent fully vaccinated, having completed the series of two doses or more, is 51.3% of the population. The age 65 to 74 population is the most heavily vaccinated, with 80.2% fully vaccinated, an achievement we should celebrate. And 28.8% of children ages 5 to 17 are now fully vaccinated. 70.6% of the overall population age 18 and older has now received at least one dose of vaccine. That is an important milestone set last year by President Biden. 61.4% of the 18 and older population is now fully vaccinated, having completed the series of at least two doses. Next slide. Last year, the COVID-19 Joint Task Force set a goal of vaccinating 70% of the entire population of Shelby County, and we are now closing in on that goal. More than 472,822 residents are now fully vaccinated, representing 51.3% of the total population, and 59.2% of the total population has received at least one dose of vaccine. We are making progress each week to reach this goal, and that is the end of these slides. The Shelby County Health Department is pleased to announce a new drive-through testing site located in North Memphis, now providing COVID-19 testing 6 days per week. The site at Gethsemane Garden Church of God in Christ at 1740 Valentine Avenue is providing testing from 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Saturday and is open from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. every other Wednesday. This testing site is made possible through a partnership with Tennessee Department of Health and the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. The drive-through COVID-19 vaccination site at 1234 Finley Road, Southwest Tennessee Community College, will reopen this Friday and Saturday to provide first, second, and third or booster doses to anyone age 12 or older. The site was closed last weekend due to the ice storm and power outages. SCHD is partnering with the Amigos Foundation to offer vaccinations at the Salon Monarca at 4350 Stage Road this Sunday from 12 to 5 p.m. This is the first of five vaccination events at that location. Spanish interpretation and assistance will be provided for those for whom English is a second language. Pfizer vaccine will be provided for anyone age 5 years and older. Additional vaccination dates at Salon Monarca are March 6th, March 27th, April 17th, and May 8th. And finally today, because all the indicators show positive trends at this time, the Health Department and Joint Task Force are going to provide these briefings every other week for the next month, with the next one scheduled for February 24th and March 10th. The March 10th briefing will be our final scheduled news briefing unless conditions warrant them to resume. However, SCHD and the Joint Task Force will continue to provide daily data updates on the data page on the shelby.community website. And with that, I will turn it over to Chief McGowan.
Thank you, Dr. Taylor, and apologies to everybody for our getting started a little bit late. You may have mentioned that there was an accident on I-40 that prevented us from getting here and starting on time, so got here as quick as we could. I do want to also express my thanks to everybody in this community who has come together to do such good work over the last 7 days in the face of some daunting challenges, literally the second largest impact and power outages in our community in our history. So. So many people coming together to do so much work to serve people who are in need. I know it's frustrating for people who are still without, the 25 to 26,000 still without, but so many people came together to meet the needs of the community, and we're just so thankful. Again, Shelby County and Memphis, Tennessee, stepping up to the plate to serve others. Just a couple of points today. As Dr. Taylor said, we're having a bit of a data glitch on the hospitalization report today. We hope to have that straightened out by tomorrow, but the trends are in individual hospitals and collectively that hospitalizations are coming down at a rate of about 20% per week. That means that, you know, we were about 438 on Sunday. We should be in the 300s when we get that report towards the end of this week, and by early next week, we should be in the mid-300s or so if the trends continue. Hope to have that sorted out by tomorrow, and that is a good news sign. Our case rate is continuing to come down, and as you know, hospitalizations follow the drop in the case rate by about 2 weeks. We are staying consistent with that trend. I do want to mention two other things that we've talked about before in our war against COVID-19. One is the oral therapies that many people believe have real promise here. There are several of those on the market. One of them is showing real efficacy, but it is in very limited supply. I just took some time and confirmed with our partners at the state that they have no more supply than they had before. It's still just a trickle at this point. And it may be still some number of months into the spring and maybe even early summer before that becomes available through normal channels. Today, it's available through only one pharmacy. They will evaluate the conditions as we get more They may choose to put more outlets out there, but that's something that's just in planning now, hasn't necessarily been decided or decided on. So I would look for that in the spring and into the summer for those oral therapies, which is one more tool we don't really have in Mendo right now. The second is with respect to immunizations. I think we've all been following the news a little bit. There's one chart that we show the age groups. The next age group that's under consideration is the 6 month to 4 year olds. We think that they're probably 2 weeks away or maybe even a week away now from the initial consideration. And it should be towards the end of this month, assuming everything goes fine, that emergency use authorization for a vaccine, a two dose vaccine for 6 month to 4 year olds should be given that emergency use authorization. Again, assuming no hiccups in the process. So again, now we'll have another chart up there that we can show another cohort of individuals who are now eligible to receive the vaccine. And that is certainly good news from where we were when we began this journey 2 years ago. So with that, I will wrap up my comments. Again, thanks to everybody for coming together and showing how Shelby County and Memphis treat each other by taking care of each other over the last 7 days. And quite frankly, over the last 2 years of this pandemic. So with that, I'll open it up for questions.
Reminding all of our participants in queue to unmute themselves, please. First up will be Kelly Roberts, WMC-TV.
Thank you. Chief McGowan, you were just mentioning some of those oral therapeutics. I know you didn't name it by name, but one of them, the Paxlovid, I think, the Pfizer pill, is that one of the ones you were referring to that is kind of in short supply here? I've been reading that this has been really a great drug for treatment, but there has been some criticism of the federal rollout. So could you shed any more light on just what the situation is with that drug here and just what you have learned just about the efficacy of it in treating COVID-19 and the benefits that it could bring to the community here with more supply? Thanks.
I will leave the medicine to Dr. Taylor on the I do know what you just said is true, that there's one that is highly effective, but I will confirm that it is in short supply, not just here in Memphis and Shelby County, not just in the state of Tennessee, but across the country. It's a miracle that we have that treatment this quickly. We are just a few short weeks or months away from having it as all forecasts are before we actually get it in numbers. So that's where we are. I just confirmed that with our partners at the state this morning to see if they had any breaking news, any new shipments coming in. They really don't. And so that's why it's been limited to the one pharmacy system to this point. Obviously, the more tools we have, the better we are to combat this. And so, Dr. Taylor, do you have any comments with respect to effect and those kinds of things?
Thanks for that question, Kelly. So what we know about this particular drug is that if a person is treated within the first few days of their illness with COVID-19, it is not only preventing a lot of severe outcomes and death, of course, it's preventing hospitalization, but it appears to be also shortening the course of the illness. So more to come with that. For the next briefing, we'll try to bring you a little bit more information on that if you all would be interested. But unfortunately, like Chief McGowan shared, the state only got a certain amount, just a small allotment, and this is the case for every state across the country. And so it's only being, of course, it's a prescription drug, so you have to have a prescription from your doctor to get it, and it is in short supply. But as soon as those supplies increase, we'll be able to pass that information on to you.
Thank you. And Dr. Taylor, this is kind of a broad question, but you mentioned March 10th at this point will most likely be the last briefing of this sort. And I know that that is, I think, maybe a give a few days, basically the 2 year mark of when, we had our first confirmed COVID case here in Shelby County. you know, even just listening today, you know, talking about how, you know, you guys are still pushing out the vaccination message and more testing sites are still being open, you know, kind of looking toward this 2-year mark and, you know, a possible big change happening with these briefings that we've become so used to, where are you guys turning the corner in messaging or things like that for this pandemic strategies, that sort of thing? I mean, can you tell me a little bit about, you know, the vision here moving toward, you know, marking this 2-year anniversary and where you guys go from here? Thank you.
I wouldn't call that a prodding question. It's a good question. And really, we're turning the same corner that health departments and city and county governments are turning across the country. Frankly, it's been a long 2 years, and everything is going in the right direction. And I think I've said this before, but we've had 2 years of practice with this. I just am glad that I was able to step into this role at a time where, like Chief McGowan said, the city and the county have come together and the municipalities to really come up with a strategy to try to protect as many Shelby County residents as possible. But I will tell you that public health will continue to do the job of public health. The Shelby County Health Department will continue to encourage vaccinations, not only against COVID-19, but against all of the diseases that we have vaccines for. We will continue to promote and improve the health of Shelby County residents through that type of messaging. And on the COVID-19 front, we will still provide data and we will still make sure that people understand if you have any symptoms that look like COVID-19, make sure that you're either using your at-home test or going to one of those community testing sites or eventually going to your provider to get tested to make sure that you know your status and that you're not passing viruses.
Michaela Watts, Commercial Appeal.
And Chief McGowan's going to come and make a few comments about that as well.
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. Can y'all hear me?
Yeah, go ahead, Michaela.
Okay, great. This question is for Dr. Taylor. I have just one question today, and it's regarding long COVID. I am curious if there's any type of centralized reporting in Shelby County that is tracking the numbers of our residents who are now dealing with long COVID. Basically, I'm trying to find out if we even have an idea of how many citizens out of all infected have contracted the long COVID form of this disease. Thank you.
Great question, Michaela. As of now, we do not have data on that in one centralized location. I'm quite sure that it is data that we will begin to try to collect. As you can imagine, because of the variety of symptoms that go along with what some people are calling long haulers syndrome from COVID, it's hard to have that in a centralized location right now. But I would suspect that just like public health does with other chronic illnesses, it will be data that we will be able to collect over the next couple of years to see how much that has affected the population of Shelby County.
Jasmine McCraven.
Good afternoon, everybody. This question is for Dr. Taylor. I just have two today. You guys have mentioned that we are finally seeing downward trends for hospitalizations, and we've also seen the same for daily cases. Is it safe to say that we have officially reached the very end of the Omicron spike? And how long do you expect this trend to continue before we were to see another spike?
Oh, wow, Jasmine, you're hitting me with the hard question today. So I would say that we are pretty safe in saying that we are toward the tail end of the Omicron spike, just because we still are seeing about 400 new cases a day. So we're still not as low as we have been when we officially declare that a surge is over. With that said, all of the numbers are going in the right direction. The question about when there may be another spike is just too hard of a question for anybody to answer at this point. It has a lot to do with the population that you're living in. So if I take Shelby County, for instance, we're a little bit over 50% vaccinated of the total population. We would prefer to be northwards of 70%. And like Chief McGowan shared, we are close. We're on the cusp of seeing a vaccine for children 6 months to 4 years. As a pediatrician, I can tell you that will be a game changer, especially if we can convince a good number of parents to take advantage of that vaccine when it comes online, because it means it will be even more people in the community at younger ages able to be protected from COVID-19 and less likely to spread virus across the community.
Thank you.
All right, Bria Jones, WREG.
Hi, this question is for Dr. Taylor. You mentioned reversing the declining trend of vaccinations, and I was wondering what approach do you plan on taking to get that number back up? And the second question, the Super Bowl is supposed to be this weekend. I wanted to know what guidance are you offering people who may be gathering to watch the game and sharing snacks and having a great time? And do you think that could lead to an increase in COVID numbers? That's it.
Well, we certainly hope not. Like I was saying before, we've had 2 years of practice with this. So the guidance hasn't changed. We still are recommending the same thing that the CDC recommends. Make sure that you know your status before you go to any gathering. And now that's even easier to do with the rapid at-home tests. If you're having symptoms, even if your test is negative, you should probably consider not going to that gathering because you don't want to spread it to other people. And then the best thing you can do for yourself, your family, and the community is if you haven't been vaccinated, if you haven't been boosted, make sure that you do that before you go and celebrate the Super Bowl. And then, of course, social distancing is still important. So if you go to a gathering and you don't have to sit right next to someone, don't do that. You can still sit 3 or 6 feet apart and have a great time watching the football game.
Bria, did you have a follow-up question?
Yes, I had a question about the reversing the declining trend of vaccinations.
Yes, so we have actively been pursuing several pop-up events across the county. Many of you have taken advantage of those in Shelby County, and so we will continue to do pop-up vaccine events. I shared a couple of them that are going to be going on this weekend, and we have a pretty robust schedule. There are a lot of faith-based organizations, community-based organizations that are really looking to help us get people vaccinated, and we're super excited about the interest among these organizations and, frankly, the interest in Shelby County. I think a lot of people like to go to those type of events, but remember that you can still go to vaccines.gov and find your nearest vaccine provider and get your vaccine that way. So it's going to be an uphill climb to continue to convince people to get vaccinated, but it's a fight we're willing to have at the Shelby County Health Department because we believe it's important. It's going to be protective for our community long term.
Those are all the questions in queue. Are there any closing statements?
Yes, I'm going to give it to Chief McGowan and let him end us out.
Thanks, Dr. Taylor. And really good questions today, and I'll come back to something Kelly mentioned. We are going to go to every 2 weeks for these updates, and on March 10th, that's our last plan. But, you know, I just want to come back to the very beginning. You form a joint task force to address something that you have not to this point faced, or where you need a collective effort to combat some unusual circumstances. And over the last 2 years, what we have done is put into place systems and we've built our capacity so that we can more normalize our response. And so when you think about this, I go back to the chart of immunizations that we showed. We are very proud of the fact that the folks in the 70 to 80 year old range are in the 80% vaccinated. That's something to be proud of. But remember, that number hasn't changed in 6 months. We were there and we've maintained that and incrementally going up a little bit. So what that means is we've probably fully penetrated that population. And And the folks that are going to get vaccinated are vaccinated. The folks that are not, they're just maybe a percent that are not there. During these task force briefings, we have told everybody about how to get vaccinated. We held special mass vaccination events. Now, at every corner pharmacy, at the Shelby County Health Department, there's almost no place that you can't go and get information about where you can get a vaccine if you choose to do so. The same with testing. We had to put on very special events to get testing because tests were in limited supply. Now, not only can you get a PCR test at many locations, there are rapid tests available, and more are coming, as you heard the president talk about, 800 million tests or so coming out, and I know the first of those are arriving on scene. So our systems are now in place to normalize our response to this. Now, there are still some things that we have to work on. We do have these new things coming out, new therapies. We have new immunization population that we can get to. It doesn't mean that our fight is over. It just means that, some of the questions you had about gathering for the Super Bowl was the same guidance we had for gathering for Christmas this year, for Thanksgiving last year, Christmas and Thanksgiving last year, as it was for the years before. So we're seeing our population change. People know what to do. They know if I'm sick, I should not assume that it's just a cold. People are just going to get a test, and they're choosing to mask up and not potentially infect other people. So we are normalizing ourselves and accommodating the virus so that we can live with it as well. It doesn't mean we're taking it any less seriously. It just means that there are systems and tools in place. We have gone door to door and knocked on 50,000 doors. We have made 180,000 phone calls to people's homes to share with them information. So we are pushing information out via our normal channels, and we believe that folks know what to do and can choose the right thing. So as I said at the end of the last peak, if something changes, you will be the first to know, because we will convene another joint task force briefing. So behind the scenes, we have been meeting each and every week with all of the leaders of the municipalities, all of the hospitals, all of the epidemiologists and all the laboratories, all of the schools, and leaders of every kind of operation in the cities and the counties all throughout this region. That work continues, and on a day-to-day basis, we meet, like the medical surge team meets every week to talk about what are we seeing in the hospitals, what do we need to change. So it doesn't mean we're going to stop working. It's just, if you don't hear from us, that means things are moving in the direction that we believe they should be going, and there really isn't any new information to report. So hopefully that answers some of the questions there. We will always be available to answer questions should you have them. Outside of these, just shoot them along to our communications teams, and we'll make sure we get that to you. So with that, I'll close this out, and we will see you on, what's the next one? February 24th. Okay, everybody, have a great weekend.